رسوله وصفي من خلقه وحبيبه، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وكشف الأمة، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. اللهم اجزه عنا خير ما تجزي به مرسلا ونبيا. اللهم شفعه فينا شفاعة لا نعذب بعدها أبدا. اللهم اسقنا من حوضه شربة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم طب القلوب ودواؤها، وعافية الأبدان وشفاؤها، ونور الأبصار وضياؤها. صلى عليك الله يا عالم الهدى، مهبة النسائم وما ناحت على الأيدي الحمائم. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. Praise be to Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He extended our life and blessed all of us and gave us that wonderful opportunity to recognize, celebrate, and enjoy wonderful events during this month of Rajab, the seventh month of the lunar calendar, the eighth month of the lunar calendar, Sha'ban, followed by the month of Ramadan. That's why we're so thankful and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has extended our life and give us that wonderful opportunity to witness and recognize and to study what took place 1400 years ago in those 3 months of the lunar calendar, Rajab, Sha'ban, and Ramadan, and benefit from them for our own selves. The month of Rajab. Today would remark 16th or the 17th of the month of Rajab. What happened during this month? What is there in order to celebrate and to recognize and to enjoy? Al-Isra wa al-Mi'raj. The night journey of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Mecca to Jerusalem, Al-Quds in Palestine, and Al-Mi'raj being sent up to the heavens, the seventh heavens, and beyond the seventh heavens. As we have seen last week, in order to understand how Al-Isra wa al-Mi'raj is a gift, is a reward, is a wonderful miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have to study what happened before that event took place. Now Al-Isra wa al-Mi'raj, according to lunar calendar, the Hijri calendar, and as we studied from the biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, took place on the 12th year after the revelation of the Qur'an, the Wahy, from Allah to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we're remarking now the 12th years of the Ba'tha, of that mission of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Al-Isra wa al-Mi'raj took place. What happened before, as we have seen last week, what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself has gone through, what the Muslim community, the Sahaba, radhiyallahu anhum, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them, what they have suffered, and what the Quraysh people, pagans, the kuffar, the mushrikeen, were totally against that mission of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as one, and believing in him as his messenger, and the prophet, and the seal of all prophets and messengers. They have used against him all the ways, all the tactics, all the technique, in order to convince him to give up that mission of Islam, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. As we have seen last week, as it has been stated in that wonderful hadith of Uqbah ibn Abi Rabi'ah, when we have seen that how they were trying to convince him with whatever the ways in order for him to give up that mission of Islam, at-targhib wal-ighra, offers, kingdom, who can provide you with that kingdom? Money and wealth, you're the poorest of the poor, who can make you the wealthiest of people among all of us. If not, you turn down all of those offers, so it means that you are crazy. You lost your mind, but we're still willing to help you find someone to cure you, to take care of you mentally. Because you, Muhammad, you're not accepting all of those offers from us. All of our tactics, techniques, persuasive way, trying to convince him, failed miserably. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not compromise with them, did not take their offers, but he stick to the mission of Allah, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, he is the messenger and he is the prophet and the seal of all prophets and messengers before him. They went to his uncle, Abu Talib, as we have seen, as the only person in Arabia would support him and help him, convincing him that, Abu Talib, go to your nephew and convince him to give up that mission of Islam. And as we know, the answer of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Abu Bakr, Ammi, Wallahi la wada al-shamsa fi yamini wal-qamara fi yasari ala an atruka hadha al-amr ma taraktuhu aw uqtala duna. My uncle, if they have been trying to convince me to give up Islam and the mission of Islam, even if they bring down the sun to my right hand and moon to my left hand in order to give up Islam and that mission, I will never do that, even if I have to die for it. That was the answer from him. Very clear to his uncle, though Muhammad might lost the support of Abu Talib, the safety and security with him, it does not matter to him. But to compromise Islam with whatever they have been asking for, the answer is no. It is Islam, it is Allah, it is Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no matter what. No matter what. And of course, his uncle said, my nephew, whatever you said to me, whatever you have to do, you're free to do. I will never oppose what you have been doing. Though at that time, even till the time of his death, Abu Talib did not embrace Islam. Subhanallah, Rabbil Alamin. I have to think about this for a reason, for a wisdom. But anyhow, now we see how the whole community of the Quraysh people, pagans, mushrikeen, kuffar, disbelievers, are against Muhammad and his da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They never give up. The disbelievers, the Quraysh people, the pagans, they have some other means in order to either convince him to give up Islam, come to his knees, or we will do whatever we can do against you, Muhammad. Subhanallah, Rabbil Alameen. They came with that evil and devil way in order to force him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, along with the Sahaba, radwanullahi alayhi wa sallam, also embraced Islam, and at that time, they did not even reach the number of 100. They were less than 100 embracing Islam, the Sahaba of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know what the Quraysh people did? Pagans, the disbelievers, al-Kuffar at that time, they pushed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba along with him and their families to the valley on Mecca, be totally segregated from the whole community. Meaning, with the concept of nowadays that we have seen against many Muslim people and Muslim countries, the embargo, al-hisar, al-iqtisadi. We push you to the valley, away from everyone, no trade with you, no business with you, we'll never provide you with the sustenance of your life, we prevent food to reach you. Any means of life, it will never be available to you, Muhammad, along with your believers, along with their families, including the children. The embargo. Al-hisar. Wal-tajwiya. The sanction. You're aware and familiar with all of those concepts. as if history repeats itself, when they were used against Muslims in many Muslim lands. And we have seen millions of the children died, lost their lives, couldn't make it, subhanAllah, due to that economic embargo and the sanctions. Or confiscate their money in the banks, wherever that money is. But no business, no trade, no nothing, as long as you did not listen to your masters of today. And you know what I'm talking about, subhanAllah. Has been practiced against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that valley in Mecca, and for how long? 3 years. 3 years against you, Muhammad, your followers, and their families, including the children, nothing to deal with you, nothing to provide you with, no food, no nothing. We will keep you there till you die, as long as you do not listen to us and give up Islam. Till the point, subhanAllah, Rabbil Alameen, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah, along the Sahaba, radhiyallahu alayhim ajma'in, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them, along with their family members, including the children, ending up eating, subhanAllah, Rabbil Alameen, dry leaves and branches of the trees. Nothing to eat. Nothing literally to eat. About to die. This is what those pagans, the kuffar, the mushrikeen, the disbelievers did against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have another kind of people nowadays who are fighting Islam right and left, not only by sanctions, not only by embargo, but with other evil and devil means in order to do what? To kill Islam and get rid of Muslims, no matter what. We have seen it nowadays, as if we are speaking, as if we are speaking in Muslim land, though we do have the resources, but we have to control everything, either to follow what we're telling you or you die. No basic needs would be provided to you as they did with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and the children and the family members at that time. The sanction and the embargo against him sallallahu alaihi wasallam and people in each. 3 years. Some of the Arabs at that time were saying that, but this is not even one of the values of Arabs at that time. How come we do such a thing against humans, people like us? It wasn't one of the values of the Arabs at that time. I'm not saying it wasn't one of the Islamic values, no. It wasn't one of the Arab values at that time to have such a sanction and embargo against human beings. People from within, their relatives, even some of their sons who embrace Islam, some of their relatives who embrace Islam, subhanAllah. And they were debating that issue, yet they did not listen. But finally, after those 3 years, for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, along with the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum ajma'in, family member and children, never give up. It is Islam no matter what. We're willing to die for it. Till the last drop of our blood, it does not matter. Sanction, it does not matter. Embargo, it does not matter. No food, it does not matter. We're here for Allah and for Islam, and that's it. Who give up? The enemies of Islam. The planners. Those who implemented that sanction and embargo, they give up. I see. There is no way for them to give up Islam, give up Allah, give up Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now you go free. After 3 years, it is Allah's help and Allah's security, and Allah's safety, as long as you work as hard as you can for Allah and for Muhammad and for Islam. This is the very simple formula. That's why we see wonderful, great Muslims dedicated to Islam. adherent to Islam, they never give up. As if we're talking today. It is because it is one thing. Islam or no Islam. Allah or no Allah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or no Muhammad. For some, they choose Islam and Allah and Muhammad. For some others, it doesn't matter. For them, subhanAllah, rabbil alameen. We're here for Islam, no matter what, as we have seen Muslims nowadays in different places of the Muslim world. It is Islam and Allah number one, no matter what. And a lot of people would say, that's enough for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For those 12 years struggling and striving in that jihad in order for the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reach every corner of the world, in order to preach Islam, in order to teach people Islam, that's enough for you Muhammad and your Sahaba, and this would be enough. The embargo sanction did not work. All of those persuasive ways did not work. All of those offers did not work. So this would be it. Let Islam be victorious and enough is enough. But no, Allah, the test, the ibtila from Allah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself would be afflicted upon him for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see, Muhammad, you are the leader, you are the messenger, you are the prophet. Now I will test you personally. It is not you and the community anymore. It is not you and the believers anymore. It is not you and the followers anymore. It is you, Muhammad. I will test you to find out whether you stick to the mission of Islam or not, to be the prophet or not, to be the messenger or not, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You, Muhammad, will be tested. What was the first test for him? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In order to justify that miracle of al-Isra wal-Mi'raj for him, look at how much he is suffering. And look at the reward he will have from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. You, Muhammad, now, you were so delighted and so pleased that your uncle Abu Talib did not listen to that offer. It came from the Quraysh people to convince you to give up Islam, and he stick to you, and he's helping you, is supporting you, is providing you with safety and security as your uncle, yet he does not embrace Islam. Now Muhammad for Abu Talib died. The only human support on earth for him in Arabia at that time, Abu Talib died. No longer live in order to help and support Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's a real test. It's a real trial for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because most of us, once in a while, we think, if I don't have this, if I don't have that, at least I have my family to help me, to support me, my uncle, my relatives, my friends. He was the only one in Arabia, Abu Talib, his uncle, to help him and support him, provide him with the safety and security in Arabia against all of those enemies of Islam. Yet, Abu Talib died. That's it. The lesson, don't depend on people in your life. Depend on the only one, the creator, the supreme Allah. Have him as your support. Have him as your helper. Have him as your guidance. No human being. No human being to be number one as a help and support. Could be number two or three. But not number one. Have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your side, number one. In no matter what the situation you're in, the challenge you're facing, the problems you have to deal with, Allah first. Say, Ya Allah, Ya Rabb. As Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for Abu Talib died. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wished for one thing for Abu Talib before he died. In his seerah, just he wanted to hear from him one word before he passed away. Only one word from his uncle. Because he loved him so much. It was so dear to him. for Abu Talib just to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, to embrace Islam. This is the only wish Muhammad would love to have from Abu Talib. He came to him close to his mouth in his deathbed, telling him, Ya Ammi, Qulha, wa ana shahidun alayha, my uncle, say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. I will be witnessing what you're saying. I would love for you to come to Islam before you die. Only wish. Yet, no Muhammad. No. Quran revealed to you, إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُهْتَدِينَ. Muhammad, you will never be able to guide anyone to Islam according to your wish or to your will. It is Allah absolutely the supreme. With His will, He can guide anyone to Islam. It is not you, Muhammad, it is Allah. Take it or leave it, this is the way. نَكَ لَنْ تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْ. That Abu Talib, you love so much, you will never be able to guide him to Islam. No. Even a wish from your prophet and messenger, and asking Allah just to have him embrace Islam before he dies. Muhammad loved his uncle Abu Talib so much, and he would love for him to die as a Muslim. No, Muhammad, this is not your business. It is our business. We know who should come to Islam and who should not. Though he was the absolute support of the human being and provide you with safety and security, he will die not on the state of Islam. For a wisdom, for a reason. We may know it, we may not know it. But it was part of the test to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would say, Ya Allah, Ya Ali, I did not ask you for so much. I did not ask for money or wealth or kingdom or authority. It is just for my uncle to come to Islam. No, Muhammad, he's not gonna die on the state of Islam. Take it or leave it, like it or don't like it. This is the way of Allah. For Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Allah, I accept. I can't argue with you. This is your will. I cannot go against your will. And take it without any complaint. Come okay for Abu Talib to die. And هذا قدر الله. It's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is deciding for us. Is there anything, Ya Allah, you would like to test me or Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He's asking. Abu Talib is gone. Anything else, Ya Allah? Yes, Muhammad. Personal things, Ya Allah. Yes, Muhammad. It is not the community this time to test or to put in a trial. No, Muhammad. It is against you, Muhammad. What Allah? What else you would like to test me with? Muhammad, you have the Khadija radiallahu anha wa ardaha as your wife. Yes, Ya Allah. Khadija will die too. Ya Allah. What is left for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Uncle is gone. He did. He passed away. Also Khadija, the wife and the support and the money and the wealth and the mother of his kids and everything in his life. Khadija, the wife. Yes, Muhammad. Khadija should die. For any human being like us would say, this is not fair. This is not justice. How come? No. Allah has His own plan, has His own wisdom. Muhammad would love for you to stand alone. No human support for you. The absolute support would come to you from Allah only, not from your uncle, not from your wife. Khadija, radiallahu anha wa ardaha. This is the way, Muhammad. Take it or leave it, accept it or don't accept it. This is the way you have to be in. That's the test. Sometimes when we are tested in something, subhanAllah, we complain, we cry out loud. If my business is not good, Ya Allah, Why me? Look around. All the business are going well. Why my business is not going well? If it doesn't work in my schooling or my education, Ya Allah, why me? And we complain and complain and complain. When my dad died, why my dad died? You know, he's still young. When my mom died, you know, she's still young. Why not, you know, someone else? When, whatever happened to my wife, we complain. We do not accept it. We have to accept it no matter what. This is the situation. This is the test. This is the ibtila. This is the fitna. We have to accept it from Allah, because Allah, for a very simple reason, has His own plan for me and for you. It is not your plan or my plan. It is Allah's plan. As long as you're working so hard in anything in your life, in your education, in your business, in your career, whatever, you do your best, leave the rest from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Plan, no matter what, you plan, but leave the best planner ever is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to plan for you. This is the way. And anyone would think that this is your prophet, this is your messenger, he's not working for something personal for himself, he's working for Islam. Leave Abu Talib for him, leave Khadija for him, give him money, give him resources, give him support, give him more, you know, of those to come to Islam. No, Muhammad, we'll test you. We will test you in the community as well as in yourself with the most beloved ones to you, Abu Talib, your uncle, and Khadija. That year, if you read the history and the biography of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, was called Aam al-Huzn, the year of grief and sadness. Because everyone around would look at Muhammad ﷺ. In one year, Muhammad, Abu Talib died. The same year, Muhammad, Khadija died. And all of the enemies of Islam are surrounding you, trying to convince you or persuade you or to convince you or to force you to give up Islam. Yet you're saying still, La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. That's the way. That's the lesson we have to learn today. La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. No matter what. If my wealth is gone, it's okay. My money is gone, that's okay. If my business is not good, that's okay. If it's slow down, that's okay. If my education is not going really well, as long as I'm doing my best, working so hard, leave the rest of Allah. Let Him plan for you. That's the way. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that situation, waiting for the miracle of Allah, the gift of Allah, it is al-Isra wal-Mi'raj for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a very miraculous way. And that's what we celebrate and recognize and enjoy to tell us one thing. Work as hard as you can for Allah no matter what. You'll be tested by Allah. But Allah has been reserving for you a wonderful reward and a gift. لازلنا في رحاب المصطفى البر لا يبلى والحب لا ينسى والديان لا يموت كل ابن ادم خطاء وخير الخطائين التوابون والتائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له ادعوا الله وانتم موقنون بالاجابه الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى الحمد لله واشهد ان لا اله الا الله واصلي واسلم على رسول الله صلاه وتسليما يليقان بالحبيب المصطفى النبي المجتبى صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى اله وصحبه وتابعيه وتابعي تابعيه الى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, our sons and daughters, the future of Islam, inshallah رب العالمين. It's a wonderful event. It is a miracle. It is a gift from Allah for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself and for us as well. Al-Isra wa al-Mi'raj, the night journey from Mecca to Jerusalem, to Al-Quds, to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, the furthest mosque. Are we waiting for some gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are we waiting for some help from Him? Think of what you have suffered in this dunya. Think of the deaths you have gone through. either in your money, in your wealth, in your business, in your education, in your family, with your relatives, with your friends. This is from Allah. Take it in a positive way and think of a reward, of a gift from Allah waiting for you. But it is not according to your time and planning. It is in accordance to Allah's time and planning. When it will happen, don't question. How it would happen, don't question. What it is, don't question Allah. Just keep going and Allah will help you. Allah will help you. Allah will provide you with a gift. Sometimes even to the level of a miracle, subhanAllah, and you think, how it happened? How it happened? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that point, the death of Abu Talib, the death of Khadija, and keep calling people to come to Islam, waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help and support. But it's more rejection for people in Mecca. More of ridiculing him. More of calling him names, bad names, nasty names. يعني مجنون. You name it, crazy, you lost your mind. You have all of this and you're still calling for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How come? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no give up. No matter what, I will keep working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you guys in Mecca are not accepting Islam anymore, not accepting La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, I will go somewhere else. I will leave Mecca, go to anywhere in Arabia or outside Arabia to call people to come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it was his decision to do the following. Leave Mecca, go to At-Ta'if, the second largest city in Mecca at that time, in terms of trade, business, and acts of worship. Maybe people there would be more accepting to Islam compared with those who are in Mecca. Hopefully, they would come and embrace Islam. Hopefully, they would come to La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, as long as the people of Mecca are not accepting Islam anymore. Go for more miles, in tens, in hundreds, in thousands, in order to convince people to come to Islam. Do not go and sleep and take the back seat and say, I give up. There is no way, you know, to preach for Islam or to teach Islam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Mecca to At-Ta'if. He went to At-Ta'if then, thinking people there would be more lenient, more decent, more encouraged to come to Islam. But he found out totally the opposite. Totally the opposite. Even in their Arab tradition to welcome a guest in their town, they did not even welcome him. They did not care about him. They ridiculed him in the nastiest way ever, sending their children. Not them, their children, stones in their heads. Go stone Muhammad. Make sure he dies. Make sure blood is all over. Get him out of the town. Do not let him to be among us, children. And they did. They did. After Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is stoning him right and left, the children of Ta'if at that time. Who was with him? Zayd ibn Haritha. His helper. One person. One. Not a big army to go with him. No tens and hundreds of guards around him. No help and no support. No tanks, no military equipment. No military vehicles around him. For the cowardice of the cowardice, nowadays, they are hidden somewhere and running for president. Cowards. Why? Because they are fighting Islam and Muslim. They can even come to their own people and say, here I am, and I'm communicating with you. And help me and support me as long as I'm running for this. Elect me. They are hiding for Muhammad with one person. were in Taif to call them for what? For Islam. Stoning him till he dies, it is okay. Blood is all over, that's okay. For Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the role model for us Muslims. We have to follow. Not to follow those idiots, those cowards, those betrayers of Islam. Follow Muhammad and his teaching. Anywhere we are, this is the way it should. Don't be manipulated. Don't take their message, you know, this way. They are playing games with Muslims, subhanAllah, Rabbil Alameen. Wallahi, wallahi, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is qadir and qahir, inshaAllah, Rabbil Alameen. This is the way. This is the way. For Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a Taif, even if you have to be stoned, even if blood all over, even if I have to die for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the way. For him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that situation, the only thing he remembered is Allah. The only thing he was worried about, whether he's doing his job or not. The only thing he would do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether he is working so hard in the da'wah of Islam or not. Asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this wonderful way of relating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma inni ashku ilayka da'fa quwwati wa qillata hilati wa hawani ala al-nas. Ya arham ar-rahimin, anta rabbul mustada'afin wa anta rabbi. Ila man takiluni, ila ba'ini yatajahamuni, am ila ajumun man labdahu amri. In lam yakun bika ghadabun alayya fala ubali. Ghayr an afiyataka hiya awsa'uni. A'udhu bi nuri wajhika alladhi ashraqat lahu dhulumat. وصلح عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة من أن يحل علي غضب أو ينزل بي سخط لك العتبى حتى ترضى ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. الله أكبر يا محمد، الله أكبر يا رسول الله، الله أكبر يا نبي الله. In that situation blood is all over, about to be killed, but he's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help and support, and he's afraid that he's not doing his job. Calling for the way of Allah. That's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It does not matter. We learn the lesson. We should do as much as we can for Islam today. Fighting against Islam and Muslims is all over. But follow Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We'll come back to him in a Taif before we go with him in that journey with Isra wal Mi'raj. Inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Inshallah. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات، إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، وأعلي بفضلك رايتي الحق والدين، وانصرنا على عدوك وعدونا يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصر من نصر أمة محمد واجعلنا منهم، واخذل من خذل أمة محمد ولا تجعلنا منهم. اللهم ول أمورنا خيارنا ولا تول أمورنا شرارنا. اللهم لا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا. اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا، وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا، وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا، واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير، واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر. اللهم اشف مرضانا، وارحم موتانا، وفك أسرانا، وفك أسرانا، وكن لنا ولا تكن علينا، ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا. اللهم برحمتك عمنا، واكفنا شر ما أهمنا، وعلى الإيمان الكامل والكتاب والسنة توفنا، وأنت راض عنا. اغفر اللهم لنا ولإخواننا في الله تعالى، أحياء وأموات، ولكل المسلمين أجمعين. إليه هذا حقنا لا يخفى عليك، وهذا ضعفنا ظاهر بين يديك، فعاملنا بالإحسان إذ الفضل منك وإليك، واختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمركم بثلاث وينهاكم عن ثلاث، إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم، اشكروه يزدكم، قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم ويرحمكم الله، وأستودعكم الله.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر.